Now, here's some news you need to know. The Annie Armstrong Easter offering for North American Missions Emphasis is underway. You can give to this offering through our online portal or by placing your cash or checks in the special Annie Armstrong envelopes available in the lobby. All ISBC High School and adult ladies and friends are invited to the ISBC Ladies Mini Retreat entitled Look Up. The event will be held at Summit Companies in Bristol on Saturday, April 23rd from 9 to 1 p.m. You can sign up online through the Church Center app or in the link in the Connect email. Secret Church is coming up soon. Here's more about it from Elijah Cox.
This past Friday, April 15th was...
Hey guys, Connor Scares here. Elijah couldn't make it right now. I just want to let you know about Secret Church. It's happening April 29th. The sign-ups ended on April 15th. However, we still have a few spots open. So if you'd like to sign up, please do so as soon as possible. We're going to have food and drinks, and we need to get an accurate head count. So please sign up on the Church Center app.
Registration is now underway for Vacation Bible School at ISBC, which will be held June 27th through July 1st. We are looking for kids and volunteers to star in our big production entitled Spark Studios. Register in the Church Center app or in the link in the Connect email. If you are visiting with us today, please aim your smartphone camera at the QR code on the screen or on the worship bulletin and follow the link to let us have a record of your visit that we can follow up with information about who we are and what's available for you and your family. As always, if you would like to know what your next steps are in your discipleship journey or how you can continue to grow with the flow at Indian Springs Baptist Church, please stop by our Next Steps table in the lobby and chat with the host. You may also check us out on our website at isbc.org or find us on Facebook at Indian Springs Baptist Church.
Well, good morning. It is so good to see you this morning. We're thankful that you're here. We've gathered this morning to worship and praise the risen King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we are so thankful you're here. Luke 24:1 says this, "On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the tomb bringing the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone was rolled away from the tomb. They went in but did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men stood by them in dazzling clothes. So the women were terrified and bowed down to the ground. 'Why are you looking for the living among the dead?' asked the men. 'He is not here, but he has risen.'" And we believe this morning our Lord lives and is alive today, and we are thankful to be able to come together and to worship him in spirit and in truth. Let's stand together as we sing this great hymn, "Christ the Lord is Risen Today."
Sons of men and angels.
praise Him with your hands this morning. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. We have a very special service for you this morning. We are going to be presenting a musical program called Believe. And this is the gospel story of our Lord Jesus Christ that tells the entire story. And this morning, you're going to see some biblical characters come to life before your eyes as we share the gospel stories. We ask you to just worship along with us this morning. We're going to invite you to stand and sing with us several times during the program. So please, just when those moments come, stand and sing together. When you hear something you like, if you want to clap, that is okay with us. We're clapping not for us, but for the Lord, and praising Him and thanking Him for the glorious music. About halfway through the service, our deacons are going to come and give you the elements for the Lord's Supper. And we invite you just to hold on to those. And when Pastor Kevin comes and narrates, he will kind of lead us through the Lord's Supper. So just sit back this morning. Let the Lord bless your heart as the Holy Spirit leads and guides us all together. Let's pray, and then we'll jump into Believe. Heavenly Father, what a blessing it is to be able to gather here this morning in your house at Indian Springs Baptist Church on Sunday morning, April the 17th, bringing glory and honor to your name. We celebrate, we rejoice in our risen King. Father, we know you're alive. We know you're living in our hearts, Father, in and through us, and we praise your name for that today. We pray this morning that every single thing done in this place is done for one reason and one reason alone, and that's to bring glory and honor to you, Father. Let your Holy Spirit fill this place, Father. Let us feel your presence in the room. Change our hearts. Help us to be different when we go out than when we came in, Father, and help us to take the gospel message as a light to Kingsport, the Tri-Cities, and all around the world, Father. We give all of this to you when we praise your name on high. We ask it in the holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Thousands of years ago, King Solomon said, "What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun."
So over and over, we experience conflicts which have occurred before.
In one familiar incident, a small religiously dominated country was invaded and quickly overwhelmed by a modern, powerful military. The victors brought with them an advanced system of justice, culture, and beliefs.
But bands of religious extremists made frequent attacks against the occupiers. Under threat of further war, the religious leaders agreed to keep the radicals under control, and an uneasy peace began.
This was Judea. Superpower was Rome, and on the week before Passover in 32 AD, yet another charismatic leader was closing in on the Judean capital. This posed a threat to both the Roman governor Pilate and the religious leader Caiaphas. The charismatic leader was from Nazareth. They called him Jesus.
What Pilate did not know, and what Caiaphas may have only suspected, Jesus had no intention of confronting the Romans. He promised a much more permanent freedom.
The first thing I learned as governor of Judea was that, like everywhere else I served Rome, no matter where you go, information is always for sale. I knew Jesus was coming to Jerusalem a full day before he arrived. I could have stopped him, but he didn't seem to be the threat Caiaphas thought he was. He terrified Caiaphas. But Jesus was not another Barabbas. That was obvious. He wasn't accumulating weapons or thugs. You know what I thought? I thought he posed more of a threat to the Pharisees than to Rome.
Pilate warned me. He knew Jesus was on his way to try to overthrow the Romans. Our agreement was that if I could control the people, the Romans wouldn't attack the temple. I'm the chief priest. I decide what God wants, not some tradesman who thinks he's a rabbi. If I didn't stop him, Pilate would. He made no secret of it. I couldn't let one man, Jesus, risk the entire nation. The Romans would tear down the temple, and nobody could rebuild it. King of Judea, Jesus would only be the king of rubble.
Jesus is my son, my boy. I heard every word he spoke growing up. He wasn't a zealot. Everyone thought he was coming to Jerusalem to overthrow the Romans. They were wrong. He was more concerned about the burden of the Pharisees than the burden of the Romans. He didn't want to be king of their world. He wanted to be the servant of the world. His disciples hadn't figured this out. Not even Thomas, probably the most cynical man I knew.
We were reaching the point of no return, and I knew it. The other 11 knew it too. You could see it in their eyes. We were only a few hours from Jerusalem, and the momentum was carrying us along. We had no idea what to expect. Peter even had a sword. Only Jesus seemed to know exactly what was going on. Jesus is destined to be our Messiah. I've read the scriptures, but how he becomes king is beyond me.
From the beginning of time, God had a plan.
The problem was that men had their own plans. Pilate had his plan to keep order in Judea. Caiaphas had his plan to keep power in Jerusalem. The disciples' plan was to rule with Jesus in his kingdom.
The people of Judea had no plan. They only had a thirst for their Messiah.
But for once, all the questions and all the fear faded into the cheers of the people. This is what we had waited for.
The mob was delighted. They needed to be quiet. They were agitating the Romans.
I had never seen that kind of reaction. I'd never been happier for my son. If Jerusalem had really known him, they would have showered him with their praise long before this.
I couldn't believe the crowds. They screamed and they cheered. They were expecting Jesus. I thought maybe they finally understood. Maybe our salvation was near, and maybe it was time.
Everything I had heard of him led me to believe that he knew what he was doing. He was politically smart, so he had to know he was crossing a line. Conflict with the Sanhedrin was unavoidable once he came back to Jerusalem and...
Jesus had no idea what he had done by coming back. We didn't condemn him. He condemned himself with his own words. He desecrated the temple with violence when he attacked the money changers. He violated the Sabbath with healing and harvesting, and he taught others to ignore us, the Pharisees. God put us in charge of this ignorant, greedy nation. We run the temple. Jesus is not our king. Caesar is our only king.
He couldn't have overthrown us. I doubt that was ever even in his mind.
Hypocrite. He turned the people against their own leaders, and then he had the audacity to hold a Passover Seder with his followers. What could he possibly be telling them? No doubt firing them up with his desire for power, or planning how to save himself when the insurrection came.
Actually, what Jesus was preparing his disciples for was what was to come next. While they wondered about who would have the most power in his kingdom, Jesus, the Son of God, washed their feet as a servant. The Son of God as a servant. He was not in need of salvation. He was to be the Passover lamb, the sacrifice that provides salvation.
Jesus knew he was going to die as a sacrifice for everyone. The disciples, the Sanhedrin, Pilate, you. The disciples didn't understand. We can excuse them. But we sit in his presence now fully aware of what Jesus intended and what he did. Jesus knew 2,000 years ago what was happening in that room would affect you today, right here. It was and is a time to celebrate the final Passover, the one at which the blood of the Lamb is on the doorpost for all of us.
You are humble, you are gentle, breathtaking beauty, life-giving touch. We who are empty, we who are hungry, frail and unworthy, needing so much. But you've called us worthy and able to meet with you here at your table, here where you serve us and here where you feed us. It's here that our time serve
they were eating, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, made." Then Jesus gave his disciples the chance to be the first to drink from the cup that represented the forgiveness of his blood. "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, the forgiveness of my sins." And they drank.
It was because he trusted people too much. He was realistic about people. He seemed able to see into their hearts. He knew their motivations, their hopes, their dreams. He also knew their jealousies and their weaknesses. So when it was one of his own who betrayed him, I was surprised. But I knew he wasn't.
At dinner, Jesus told Judas Iscariot that he would be our betrayer. Then Judas left. Things seemed to be spinning out of control.
We went to Gethsemane after Seder. Jesus took James and John and went to a private place to pray and left the rest of us to keep watch. Twice Jesus came back and found us asleep. The second time, we could hear people coming. And guess what? It was Judas leading a group of temple guards.
And there stood Judas. Now this is the part where I'm supposed to say it all became clear then, but it didn't. Did Judas do it for the money? Was it for the power? Jealousy? He always wanted to be more important in the group. He'd ask me, "John, why are you going with Jesus and not me?" As if that mattered. He wasn't the leader of the group, Jesus was. Maybe Judas just wasn't ready to be second to anyone.
When the mob came to take him, we knew the danger. I always thought I was ready to die for him until it came time to do just that.
And what do you think we did? We ran. Tell yourself every day that you would do different and you'd still be wrong. Only Peter ran in the direction of where they took Jesus. Maybe he had more courage than we did.
When we are unfaithful, Jesus is faithful. On the night Jesus was arrested, he was abandoned by every man who had followed him. Instead of calling the whole thing off, he continued to the cross. Sometimes it's easier to believe he died for the Romans than it is to believe he died for the very people who had pledged their lives and honor to follow him, only to see them betray him, deny him, and run.
And they brought him to me. Me, as if I had a grievance with him. Why, he wasn't a Roman problem. He was their problem. I couldn't find anything he had done which violated Roman law. The Pharisees just wanted a quick political killing. No, not me. Something was unusual about that one. Several of the garrison soldiers and more than one centurion believed Jesus was who he said he was. Even my own wife. She had a dream about Jesus. She warned me to have nothing to do with him. He was innocent, she said.
I believed so much over those few years, and then it seemed that everything I did believe had died. All of us. All of us said that we would die for him, but we didn't. So when they told me that Pilate was going to have him crucified, why would I believe them? I didn't even believe myself anymore.
No, I didn't get the strength to find out what had happened to Jesus until he was already headed to the cross. And when I saw him there, it was almost too much to bear. Would he speak to me? Would he look at me? Would he spit on me? And do you know what he did? He asked me to care for his mother.
And Jesus died, the final Passover lamb.
A lamb who went willingly to his death. A lamb who struggled with every ounce of his strength just to reach the base of the cross, where his sacrifice would be completed.
Blameless, but knowing that the blame for every wrong ever committed or ever would be committed was about to be put on him, and that he would pay the price for all of the sins, all of the pain man ever created.
Justice commanded a price be paid, but God paid our price. Since God delivered the Israelites to freedom by using the blood of the Lamb, the world waited for God to deliver each person to freedom, again, by the blood of the Lamb.
Worthy is
I was actually surprised he made it to Golgotha alive. If I hadn't known it was Jesus, I wouldn't have believed it was him. He was unrecognizable. Bloody, swollen, disfigured from his lashings. How could anyone do this to a person?
Overwhelming feelings poured over me. I was near panic at the thought of seeing my child killed in front of me. I was sure seeing him die would kill me too. But inside, I knew I had to be there. I'd been there for him since the day he was born. I was the first to hold him, to keep him warm, to hold his hand when he was scared as a child, to rub his forehead when he was sick. So I knew I had to be there then, whatever happened.
Oh,
Caiaphas wanted soldiers guarding the tomb every minute. He was spreading the rumor that the followers were planning on stealing the body. What I think he was really afraid of was that Jesus was actually going to rise from the dead.
Calm, and our authority was respected again. Still, Jesus wasn't behind us, not yet. But in 2 days, we were going to prove he was a fraud. We could stop any uprising in his name by simply showing the body.
We didn't know if the Romans or the Sanhedrin would come after us next. I went back and forth between terror that they would kill us and fear that they wouldn't.
My sources told me that the disciples of Jesus were hiding in locked rooms all over the city. They were demoralized, defeated. They didn't know whether to run or hide. I had no more to fear from them. These were not men who had come to Jesus for money or influence. With him dead, they weren't interested in a hoax that would probably lead to their deaths. They were packing to head back to their former lives. If I did my job well, Rome would never again hear the name of Jesus.
Promised him just that.
But suddenly, the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. And I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. Then he raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. Every fear I'd ever had just melted into
I sent word to the tomb early. I had expected a daily report from the guards, but they were nowhere to be found. The tomb was empty. I thought the guards were dead at the hands of the people who stole the body. If they deserted their post, they'd better be.
So they say he's gone, he's risen. I will not build my hopes up again just to see them die in front of me like they did at the Passover.
We found the guards. They claim to have seen angels and Jesus walk from the tomb. I suppose that's what I would have said too if I was about to be executed. There's no excuse in the Roman Legion for deserting your post. I reminded them of that. I told them that their only hope was to say that they'd been overpowered by grave robbers. To help them with their story, we gave them some money, and I went to Pilate on their behalf.
There were rumors that Jesus had appeared to people after the tomb was found empty. But what changed my world was when Jesus appeared to me. Several of us were hiding in a room, begging God to tell us what we should do. And then Jesus came into the locked room, not a ghost, but a person with a physical body. And at that instant, I changed forever. But Thomas wasn't there.
John looked like he had seen a ghost. He believed he had seen the Lord. But unless I saw and felt the nail marks in his hands and touched the wound in his side, I wasn't gonna believe it.
Thomas needed to physically see, and I couldn't blame him. It wasn't until I saw Jesus alive that my belief turned around.
It had been 2 weeks. The others were convinced. But if he was real, I would know. Then, while we were all together eating dinner, I heard a familiar voice, "Peace be with you." And before I turned, I knew it could only be one person, and it was him. There were the nail holes and the wounds in his side.
he believed. My hope had not deserted me. Only my faith had died. But it too had been risen from the grave. Jesus was alive, and I believed. My Lord and my God. Just weeks before, those 11 men had been crying in locked rooms, too afraid to come out. But after the reported sightings of Jesus, they were changed. They said he was in Galilee, and there they went. They became fearless. They became bold. And for the first time since I knew them, they did not seem to be afraid of death. The hope that had turned to despair now turned to belief. I'm afraid that now Rome will have to hear of Jesus.
Rome was the first world power to come in contact with Christ. It was also the first to convert to Christianity.
In less than a month, the disciples were boldly preaching Christ resurrected, fearless in the face of death. Eventually, all but one would be martyred in the name of Jesus.
What changed them? Why would they so readily sacrifice the lives they had fought so hard to keep? Men who seek money, power, or influence fear death more than any other man. The only thing which could explain that phenomenon was belief.
A belief that went beyond simple acknowledgement of a fact. You see, it's not enough to simply believe. Belief is completed by the decision to follow. And in Judea, 2,000 years ago, after Passover, 11 followers of Jesus of Nazareth believed, and the world was changed.
Thomas had the opportunity to believe because he was able to see Christ risen. But we have an even greater opportunity. Jesus told Thomas, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe."
We call you now with many
Amen. Give them glory this morning with your hands. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
He is risen. I know it's an amazing irony that they would cast the most despised character in the whole production to be the associate pastor of Indian Springs Baptist Church. It's poetic, really. Listen, you've heard enough gospel in what has been presented through music and song today to miss hell and make heaven. But for those who may be here, I want to just take a few short moments to put a finer point on it. The truth is that an almighty God created the universe. He created the heavens and the earth, and he created mankind, all for the purposes of bringing glory and honor to him. And it was good, and it was perfect. But then along the way, sin entered into the world. Sin is anything that goes against God's word. It's choosing your own standard in your own way over God's way. And it only took one sin to break everything. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That means that everyone in this room, everyone on this stage, has chosen our own path. We've chosen to ignore God's standards and his precepts, and we put ourselves first. That's a sin. The Bible further tells us that the wages of sin, what we earn as a result of our sin, is death. But that's not the end of the story. You see, God loved the world so much that he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. As a 17-year-old boy, I made the decision to trust Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. In that moment, Jesus became everything to me. And though we still live in this broken world and we battle sin every day, Christ died for the sins of the world. He took the penalty of all the sins ever committed and all the sins that ever would be, and he buried them in that tomb. But on the third day, he rose victorious. I don't know where everyone is in this place today, where you are spiritually speaking, but I cannot think of a better day than today to place your faith and trust in him if you've never done that. Just a moment, we're going to sing another song, a final song, and it's our invitation song. And during this song, there's going to be pastors up here. If you're averse to coming to the gold and blue guy with the big beard, there'll be other pastors here. But I would be more than happy to start a conversation that maybe we end later on this week sometime. If you've arrived here today and you know there's something inside of you that's telling you, hey, you need to get real with Jesus. You need to lay down this lifestyle. You need to lay down your sin. You need to repent of that, which just simply means to turn away from that and do a 180 and turn toward him. You can do that today. But for many others of us here today, perhaps you made that transaction at some point in the past, but you know you've been walking a guilty distance. You've strayed. perhaps you can't say that he's everything to me right now. Maybe something else has taken priority in your life. Maybe you've moved him off the throne and you're sitting on it once again, making your own choices. I don't know. But I'm here to tell you today that Jesus not only rose from the grave, he ascended to the right hand of the Father, and he is seated there in heaven on high, and he's reigning, and he will return again. So if you need Jesus today, come. We'll pray with you. If you just need to be encouraged today, pray right where you are, and he will encourage you. He will remind you that you are loved, and he died for you. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we are overwhelmed with the opportunity that we have had today to gather here as brothers and sisters in Christ to reflect on Easter, to reflect on the fact that the King of the universe sent his only Son into this world to suffer and take the penalty of sin, which is death, to suffer for our sakes. But then in defeating death, hell, and overcoming the grave, he rose so that we might rise with him. Father, I pray that you would speak to hearts, that your Holy Spirit would bring conviction. Father, that you would strengthen and embolden those who have been putting it off for far too long. May today be the day of salvation. Encourage us today, Father. Help us to be reminded that your ways are better than our ways. Speak to us, Father. These things we ask and pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Please stand to your feet as we sing our song of invitation.
In the darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father. God of glory, Majesty. rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was more than the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth alone shall not yield, shall not fade. By His blood,
amen. Hasn't it been good to be in the house of the Lord today? These folks on this stage have worked tirelessly for many, many weeks. Pastor Evan has done an amazing job putting all of this thing together and kind of keeping this truck heading down the path. Why don't once for all, why don't we just give them a great round of applause for all the hard work that they put into this? We want to thank you for coming today and giving us your time on a very, very special Easter day. And we hope that you have a wonderful rest of the day with your family. There are no further activities here on this day. We urge you to have a wonderful lunch, dinner, whatever it is you have in store, and have a wonderful time. God bless you. He is risen indeed.